esteemed Professor Manoj Das ji, Honorable Chancellor of our University, Sri H.P. Ramaji, elders from Rama family, distinguished professors from South Gujarat University, Professor Bijliwala, Head of Gujarati Department, Professor Rakesh Desai, Head of English Department, Naresh Shukla ji, elders from the town, and colleagues. A university is a space for creation of knowledge and dissemination of knowledge. Along with that, it aims at preservation as well as application of knowledge. This creation of knowledge takes place when it becomes a space for unconditional questioning, where young minds come and question various issues and contribute to knowledge with their fresh minds. At the same time, let me edit here, university becomes a university when people of universal consciousness visit it, when they come and bless the space in which we try to do our things in a bit. Today is the occasion when we have such a person with us in the form of Professor Manoj Das, whom all of us in our cultural literary circle know as Manoj Da, and the affection that emanates from his presence, simplicity, and the depth of thought that all of us would realize in his three lectures that he has kindly agreed, according to the kind wishes and invitation of our President Sri Ramaji, that despite his old age, he agreed and he is with us, traveling almost more than 18 hours yesterday. We pay our respect and salutations to him for taking all the trouble and honoring the invitation that Sri Ramaji extended and thought of blessing us. He would be speaking on saga of Indian literature. And I don't think in our country we have a better mind to do justice to this. If we look at Indian literature, one thing that we have to keep in mind is that it is difficult to separate it from philosophy, history, culture, and those who think they understand history, philosophy, culture of India without understanding Indian literature live in a world which is altogether fallacious world. If we look at the trajectory of this, we find that even by the Western historians' perspective, Vedas and Upanishads were composed almost before 8500 BC. Then the second phase came when the epics came to be written, and in epics also we were the first one, we were the cradle of first epic. We had Adi Kavya in the form of Valmiki's Ramayana, and before that we had first composition of the world in the form of Rig Veda. Whole world acknowledges that. The third phase that we had after the epics was the phase in which Shamanic literature was written. Around 500 BC, Buddha, Mahavir, all of them contributed, and in between some great literature came to be composed. The next phase we find is the phase of Bhakti discourse. That is 10,000, precisely speaking, 7th century onwards, because Andal in Tamil began writing in 7th century. So at least 10th century onwards up to 19th century, when Gangasati of Gujarati literature, who died in the last decade, was writing devotional compositions, and the Gujarat made enormous contribution in the form of Narsi, in the form of Meera, in the form of, you come down and come up to this. And then comes the phase of modern literatures in all Indian languages. It particularly the contribution that Narmad of Surat made through his writings. And from there onwards begins the modern phase. And post-50s we find what we call as post-modern phase, in which all these languages and interaction with the Western literature led to composition of different discourses. If we look at these five phases, we need to look at them as a continuous development, and not just as literature, but the way they composed, they contained philosophy in it, darshan I should say rather, the way they had the cultural implications in it, and then thus continues the tradition, what is called the Bhartiya Gyan Parampara Sanatan Ganga Pravah. This is what Pandit Narayan Shastri of Pune used to say to define Indian tradition. That is, Indian tradition is like Sanatan Ganga Pravah. It continues. He would be dealing with first he would be dealing with the Vedic and Upanishadic phase. Tomorrow he would be dealing with the epic phase, and then thereafter the Katha Sarisagar, Jatak tales, and Puranas. We do not know how will his Ganga flow, because he works in his own way, thought patterns move in a way. But for me as an individual and as a university, it's a moment of historic importance, because next year we are going to have School of Liberal Arts and Human Sciences. And this to me is the most auspicious beginning that we can ever think of. And I'm sure that in the days to come, next year, when we have it full-fledged, Professor Manoj Das will be with us to teach his great-grandchildren, great-grandstudents as well on the campus. I take this privilege on behalf of all family of the university to welcome him on the campus, and we are very eager to listen to him, as all of you would be. Equally, I take this opportunity to welcome all the guests who, despite being Sunday, have come here, and they have disproved the wrong notion that on Sunday Surat doesn't work intellectually. So it works in business terms, but intellectually also Surat works on Sundays. Thank you very much. May I request Ankita to take it forward. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for setting the tone so meticulously. And I'm really, really looking forward to the lecture today on Vedas and Upanishads. And to introduce him further to the audience, may I now request Kevalya Smarji to kindly come here and introduce Professor Manoj Dasji to the audience.
My namaste to respected Sri Manoj Das. My namaste to the entire family of Oro University here. My namaste to the guests. It is a pleasant surprise for me, and indeed a very pleasant surprise, that I am supposed to introduce Sri Manoj Das here. It's not an easy job, but he belongs to that family of which we are self-proclaimed members, the family of Sri Aurobindo Ashram, the family of the mother in Sri Aurobindo. And we have been seeing him like that for many, many years. An activist in his student life, having strong intellectual ideas, interested in literature, in Indian culture, and receiving the highest accolades from the Sahityakala Academy. Highest accolade as Padma Shri, highest accolade that of Utkala Ratna. He is a person who is so very much versatile, not only in the field of literature, not only as a critic, not only as a writer. It is very difficult to be a writer and a critic at the same time, and an author. He is a research scholar at the same time, and when the pioneer work was done by him, he went to England to look for something and came back with something most unique for the first time about Sri Aurobindo's role in the freedom fight that had taken place. We have been listening to him in Pondicherry, and it has always been a pleasure. We have very high respect for him. He has been teaching for a long time in the International Center of Education at Pondicherry, associated with several universities in India and abroad in various capacities. But the thing is, it is not what the man is that is important. The most important thing is what he makes possible. He has always been inspiring us. He has always been giving us some insight on the Indian culture, Indian literature, and Sri Aurobindo and the Mala. I introduce Sri Manoj Das with these few words, with my limited information and experience. My namaste to you, sir, once again. And I thank you all. Thank you so very much. Please come, sir. Please come.
Dear Dr. Rao, dear Dr. Avadeshji, all the distinguished friends present here, I greet you all. My greetings from Pondicherry. I must confess that I am in a dharma sankata, a crisis of decision so far as my duty is concerned. Very frankly, I had a different vision of the whole institution. I thought of teaching a group of students the fundamental spirit of the great Indian literary heritage. Since my arrival, particularly this morning, I am being taught by the environment of this institution, the precise 5 years, 6 years old history of this institution. Revelation after revelation is coming to me. I feel like a humble student. And I face not students who were in my mind, but all, I should say, makers of the students' consciousness. You are the teachers, the faculty members, others of important position. You can imagine my dharma sankat. What do I go to speak about Indian literature to you? I wanted to introduce to them what exactly the Vedas mean, the Upanishads mean, the epics mean, the Puranas mean. Because in the entire history of the world, there hasn't been another civilization where a literary tradition has been built so meticulously and chronologically, and which happens to be so living even today in the life of so-called ultra-modern genius generation of people. What is it that continues that tradition? How is it influencing us, and how it can also contribute to our future making of ourselves when you understand the real spirit of Indian literature? But I have abandoned that scheme while sitting here now. I will rather share with you some of my agonies and anguishes. Probably I will briefly touch towards the end of my talk something which will relate to the subject determined earlier, but I feel like very, very strongly, I feel like that I should not go into that kind of academic exercise. You know, today, I can't find the right word to describe the situation. Probably you are aware of the fact that in the international survey, India happens to be one of the most psychologically depressed countries. I will precisely give you the statistical figure. The latest WHO release referred to the referred to by me earlier, it is newspaper editorial, shows India at the 122nd place down in the list of 155 countries surveyed to measure the degrees of happiness the citizens enjoy. In a list of 155 countries, India's position is 122nd. And this is the country where in the entirely known history of human civilization, where first prescription against depression had been given in the Gita by Sri Krishna to Arjuna. You all know that. I need not repeat it. That is the country where we are depressed. The prescription precisely was that it is by falling from one's swadharma, when one does not perform one's swadharma, that one becomes depressed, like as Arjuna had become. He had forgotten his real swadharma, which is to fight against the evil. Now, how much we must have deviated from our swadharma as a nation, the whole of India today, to have deserved this position, 122nd in a list of 155 countries surveyed, to become depressed like this. If anything, I felt a whip of hope while discussing to my brother, H.P. Ramo. You see, I had a I should not use the word curiosity, but as I was thinking, a kind of loving attraction to see what is being done here. Year after year, he visits Pondicherry. Every time he's so kind, never fails to meet me once. He suddenly, without any appointment, he will come down to my house. I will be pleasantly surprised. And he will just tell me something is being done here. But today, while talking to him, he does not understand what I learned. But why? What I learned, I'm telling you. In course of time, he told me, in course of our talks, he told me that this basic infrastructure, this building, these faculties, they are all created before even one student joined. Casually, he said it. Instantly, what was revealed to me, a dazzling ray of hope that India has not lost faith in the future. What prompted him to begin and manifest this physical form of a soul which was yet to manifest? In one word, it is faith. What is this faith? My friends, forget about Indian literature. Let us be very conscious about one thing today. Today, if India requires anything, and which, if you can infuse into your students, the greatest of our service could be done to Mother India. It demands, it needs a faith. You see, what I mean by faith, let me explain to you. I am going completely beyond, I hope you don't mind. I am deviating from the subject. Vice Chancellor, you have your permission? Do you agree with me that I will make some free observations about more essential points than Indian academic knowledge of literature? Right? Ramaji, can I? Now, completely, I did not have this in my mind, but looking at you, I feel I must share some of my anguishes and what really is necessary and what, if we remember, can make the foundation of such institutions stronger and stronger. Today, everywhere you will see, it began, of course, long ago. Now, we had a concept of motherland. Janani janma bhumischa swargadapi gariyasi. Mother and motherland are nobler, loftier than the heavens. To be very precise, subconsciously for us, that great faith was damaged when India itself was divided. We had a great faith in religion. 20th century saw the horror of religious strifes, nations being divided on the name of religion, millions being killed, massacres taking place in the name of religion. Whether you are conscious of it or not, our subconscious cannot fail to record these horrors, and we gradually lose faith in religion. Manijya Vasati Lakshmi, Goddess Lakshmi remains in business, in enterprises, in wealth, and we have seen most wealthy people, how corrupt they are. Business people, how corrupt they are. Our faith in this ancient belief that wealth is sacred, it is a gift of Goddess Lakshmi, that also is shattered. We believe in education. Savityaja Vimuktoye. Education is that which liberates us. Liberates from what? Liberates from our bondage to ignorance. You see, we are born ignorant. I do not remember who was that great philosopher who said once that 60 years ago I believed I knew everything. Today I know nothing. Then he says, education is a continuous process of revealing to us the degrees of our ignorance. Today I learn something and I realize that I was ignorant about that. Tomorrow I learn something else. Little while ago, Bhai Rama and myself were speaking, life divine. He was referring to Sri Kiret Joshi, a distant friend of ours, both of ours, who had read Sri Aurobindo's total works 28 times in his life. I have been helping my students to understand the life divine for at least 20 years. Each time I read a chapter, a sentence, suddenly I'm thrilled with a new meaning, a new gana, something which I had neglected, which I had not, somehow I had missed earlier. So education is a gradual revelation of my ignorance. Now, today we see education has put people into more and more bondage, greater bondage of either ego or only selfishness or bare machines, electronic and otherwise. We are serfs, we are almost. For this life is full of care, no time to stand and stare, the British poet sang. Today it has become so acutely true in our life. So we have lost faith also in education. In other words, we are passing through a crisis in faith. Pardon me, because as I 18 hours of continuous travel at this age, makes me a little tired. So, what happens is there any way to restore the lost faith with which the mighty civilization was built? Nothing can be done without faith. We are not conscious of this thing. Every step I take it with faith that the earth will not give away. Every morsel of food I take with the faith that it is going to sustain, help me sustain myself. Every drop of water I drink, with faith I do it. I have come all the way to you with the faith that there will be an audience to listen to me and care for my words. You have come with the faith that you are going to share something, at least some minimum sensible things. Every moment of our life, we live with faith, but we are not conscious of it. Now, at a time when there is a crisis in faith, as I told you, institutions on which we had deposited our faith unconditionally, they have all betrayed us. Only a few months ago, you must have read a very startling statement by Hawkins, the scientist. Hawkins says, humanity must prepare to colonize another planet because in 100 years, this civilization is going to be destroyed. Suppose we go over to another planet, we are going to carry the same consciousness, the very consciousness which is going to destroy the civilization. We cannot leave behind that consciousness and export ourselves to a new colony in a different, point of space. As long as this consciousness as it is there, wherever we go, we'll make the place a semi-hell with a promise of heaven as it is, as we have made our earth today here. It is superfluous to state that any factor can completely destroy the humanity today. An occasional, as you know, in Ramayana there is a wonderful story, a beautiful anecdote. People take Sita's character as something meek and mild without reading the Valmiki Ramayana. You see, in the first few days of his life in Dandakaranya, Rama, Lakshmana, Sita, after self-exile, they are in the hermitage of a rishi. When other rishis come and meet Rama and appeal to him to destroy the demons who are destroying them, who are torturing them, tormenting, humiliating them, they're performing a yajna, they will come and spoil it, etc., etc. Every time Rama looks at his dhonu, his great bow, and the arrows, and says that the quiver of arrows, dazzling quiver of arrows, natural and supernatural powers are there imbibed in them. This is the weapon I have. I must use against them. Destroy them. 3-4 times he says that. Next day, when they have resumed their journey, Sita tells Rama, Aryaputra, I feel like telling you a story. You know, stories are the earliest form of education. Yes, Rama says, what is it? You see, once upon a time, there was a young man who was absolutely serious in his tapasya. I don't know what for he was doing his tapasya, but he wanted to first energize himself with tapasakti, great power, power of asceticism. And then some gods liked to test him. They did not send any nymph to dance before him, no. Just somebody came and put a glittering sword in front of him and went away. During a small interval between spells of his sadhana, his meditation, he saw the sword, touched it. Good to touch. Next time he unsheathed it. Third time curiosity led him to apply it on the nearby plant. It was sliced. He was charmed. Fourth time, when a deer came near, he applied it on him. Thereafter, he went on applying this sword on whosoever he saw, beast or man. And after his death, It is straight plunge into hell. Story ends. Then Sita says, Aryaputra, he was under the spell of the glittering sword. Every matter, look at the psychological insight and depth of Mother Sita. Every physical object radiates a kind of aura, radiates a kind of magnetic force. It attracts, just like power attracts. This same man will be sitting before you. Well, good man. Next day he is a chief minister or somebody is very powerful. You will feel a different kind of magnetism. Power itself is invisible. His body does not wear the power. It comes to him, it goes away from him, but then it is something invisible which has its own magnetic pull. Every material object also is possessed by a certain kind of power. A power manifests or surrounds or the matter itself gets tipped in that. I hope, not that Sita is explaining all these things, he simply says, I hope you are not under the spell of your sword. Sorry, spell of your bow and arrows. Just that young rishi was under the spell of his sword. Years ago, Bertrand Russell said the same thing. He, you know, his famous movement for, prohibiting the nuclear, making of nuclear weapons. He wanted 100 great names of the world to put, signature. I'm going a little astray. That great scientist George Santayana, a great philosopher George Santayana, but Bernard Shaw wanted him to be a signatory to this appeal to all the nations to stop experiment with nuclear power, particularly destructive experiment with power. And George Santayana did not send back the letter with his signature. Copies he had sent to 100 intellectuals. He sent a reminder. No reply. Accidentally they met someday, somewhere. And Bertrand Russell asked Santayana, did you receive, you must have read it in Bertrand Russell's life, some of you. Did you receive my letter about, yes. Reminder, yes. You did not send back the letter with your signature? George Santayana looked at him. Why are you so eager to keep this humanity alive? What does it matter if it destroyed? Nature has evolved it. If nature wants to destroy it, let it destroy it. Why are you so keen? What is so special about humanity that it has to be preserved? If not nuclear destructives, something else can destroy it, ecological, drug, war, anything can destroy it. That is one point of view. Very pessimistic point of view, of course. George Santayana was not inwardly like that, but he was irritated with human behavior, with the present condition of mankind, their consciousness. Coming back to the point. Now, every physical object has its own aura also. And that is what, Sita warned Rama about. Now, so far as this, I deviated from what? Faith, I was speaking of the faith. Now, this faith in the whole history of world literature or philosophy, today, in this age of disillusionment with every institution, everything, where do we find it? But faith is there. If faith were not there, this institution will not be there and you will not be there. Our meeting will not be possible also. I remembered once when he told me this house was this structure was built before even one student had stepped in an ancient, you know, the folklore of India, some of them are steeped with great wisdom. They are the essence of wisdom. In one such tale, there is a story, it's not very old, but still few hundred years old. People used to use in those days, anyway, I will come to that. Now, there was drought in an area, no rain. And the people went to a rishi who was nearby. Sir, apply your spiritual power to bring down the rain. He said, it's a story after all. I can invite the clouds. But whether they will rain or not, that will depend on your prayers steeped in faith. Of course, we have faith in you. We have faith in whatever you are going to do. We will come and pray. Come. So the sage used to live under a hill. Village was 2-3 miles away. So all the villagers came on a certain day, sat down. The sage, Rishi, sat in meditation. Clouds gathered. And the people were expecting rain. There was not a drop of rain. 1 hour, 2 hours. The Rishi said, enough, you can go back. But said you, sir, you said there will be rain. Yes, I said, but I said that you must pray with faith. But we have prayed with faith. No. Sir, we have prayed with faith. No. 3 miles you have come and you knew there will be rain. None, not a single umbrella you have brought. Still you say that you had faith. The anecdote shows hits at a very primary, essential force of faith. Yes, we have belief, but we don't have faith today, which practically ran our life once upon a time. Now, how to restore that faith? How to bring about, cultivate that faith in the new generation of students? That is to have faith in the future of man. Forget about the term divine or God. But at least our common sense says that evolution, if that power, what we call evolution or call it anybody else, the creative niceness you tell it, you call or call it, whatever has created this earth, right from the first hour of life, going on and on and on, creating such an intelligent, intellectual civilization. That again reminds me of Einstein. Don't believe your intellect. It has muscle power. It has no conscience. But still, intellect is there. Intelligence is there. And with intelligence, we have built up such a huge civilization. But civilization which seems to have also made us morally bankrupt. As I gave instance of from politicians to business people, to educated people, to wealthy people, everybody. Now, this paradox has to be completely breached or rather eliminated. And that future has to be depended, relied upon, that this force which has brought us so far, it has not become bankrupt by itself. That force could not have become a zero, reduced to a cipher suddenly. Suddenly it has not abandoned man to its own doing, horrible. Man can be unpredictable. Everything can be unpredictable. Civilization, culture. What culture, what civilization? The only promise is there in Sri Aurobindo's vision of the future of humanity. Through his infinite grace, he has meticulously built up what actually is not, what cannot be explained in terms of intellect, intelligence, mind, logic, argument. He alone has made the best possible use of all these agencies and presented through his magnum opus, the Life Divine, as well as other works, that indeed there is a future for man. Till a certain period, he himself was a bit skeptical, it seems. He says, if mankind does not want actually to progress further, maybe the evolutionary niceness will take a roundabout way. It will just leave man to his own fate and create something new. But subsequently, through his letters and the line of Jogo which was carried on after Sri Aurobindo left his body by the mother, it is evident that the force is not going to bypass human beings. It is going to work within the human consciousness. But the question is, Where is the collective aspiration? Where is the receptivity? Where is, despite all the blows of disillusionment humanity is facing, where is that cry that, no, I do not want this rotten life of falsehood. I have to find out a way. I have to, yet it requires courage, because this world is not false. Values may be false, but the world, once we accept that it has been created by a power, a force which knows, we cannot say the world is false. Now the question is, accepting the world as true, momentarily being run by false values, which can be eradicated if we will, and passing on to a new phase of evolution, or looking forward to a new phase of evolution, welcoming a new phase of evolution. That kind of vision must be imparted, and imparted through physically constructed institutions like this. What devotees have been doing through study circles, through centers, not a very small thing. Thousands and thousands of people are awakened to this possibility. But then, to do it academically, to combine practically with struggles of life, strives of life, with career, which cannot be abandoned, this vision, which can bring a qualitative change to everything, is an adventure which you have undertaken. We are all participants in it. Brother H.P. Ramo is the chosen instrument, but we all can become instruments the moment we have realized that there is no other way for humanity except this. One can question, what does it matter to me what is there for humanity in future? I will not be there. I tell you from my absolute guaranteed faith, you cannot escape, brothers and sisters. You have to inherit the same world in whatever condition you leave it. Rebirth is a must. Rebirth is a reality, is more real than as I see you and you see me. And we have to suffer worse if we leave this world as it is. Now, the question is how to bring these ideas into the academic syllabi according to the practical lifestyle. We have to evolve these things. We have to work for these things, no doubt. But first and foremost, we have to cultivate this faith within ourselves. And this faith, when I look back, you see, what a tremendous faith which I must touch before I end the little bit, at least the subject to which I was committed. My first series in the three talks was about the Vedas and the Upanishads. Well, mind-boggling. I won't touch about Rig Veda. We cannot understand these things unless you are a student of Sri Aurobindo. You read his commentary on the Vedas, translations partly. Some ideas we can have. But I am not going into the wisdom or the spiritual content of the Veda. I am speaking about Sanskrit language. Vladimir Bhai, you will agree with me. Behind every mature language, a great language, there has to be a great civilization. Unless there is a great culture, a great civilization, a high, lofty level of thought, words cannot express them or words cannot symbolize them. A word is a symbol of a certain reality. I say Samudra, sea, immediately the vision of sea comes to your mind. A word is a magic, it is a mantra. Now, Rig Vedic Sanskrit, it is universally agreed that it is the most mature language which can express the maximum through minimum number of words. Now, for such a language to develop, there must have been a civilization which is great, even if quite limited. It could not have been a large-scale subcontinental civilization. It could be a very limited civilization. But where is the evidence of it? Where is the history of it? When was it written? Vedas were thus primitive men's abracadabra. That was one idea floated by some European historians. Lokmanya Bal Gangadhar Tilak, in his famous book, he first wrote that the Vedas, he calculated the astronomical situation depicted in the Rig Veda and said it was written 6,000 years ago. 6,000 BC, not 6,000 years from today, 6,000 BC. Now, Madame Blavatsky, you know, the famous theosophist, founder of the Theosophical Society movement of the world, in her famous secret doctrine, Magnum Opus, she points out that this particular planetary situation repeats itself every 6,000 years. So how do you say that the Rig Veda was written only 6,000 years ago? It could be 6 lakhs years ago. It could be 60 lakhs of years ago. And she was of the opinion, like many others, that several civilizations have been lost under deluge. The concept of Pralaya, the concept of the total submersion of the present globe. Now, they have some values, but that is a very great subject. I am not going into it. Now, she says that something revives from an old civilization, and the Rig Veda is the remnant of a very, very ancient civilization. It's a codified version of that great civilization, you can say. But whatever it is, even if we take it as 6,000 years ago, where is the story of that great culture which must have supported it? We do not know. But when you read the next branch of literature, you know, in Indian, as I said, chronology of literature, the Vedas, followed by Upanishads, followed by the epics, Mahakavya, which are also called the Itihasa, which means the content are practically factual. There might have been a lot of imagination mixed with it, but practically factual. Then the Puranas, Mahapuranas, Sthala Upapuranas, Sthala Puranas, 2,000 short Puranas, but also only 18 Mahapuranas are there, which are really important. So now we find that in each of these things, when the time comes, I will try to give a very brief account of what Sri Aurobindo says. The primeval quest of man can be put under five heads. In the very beginning of the first chapter of Life Divine, God, light, freedom, immortality, and he adds also the fifth toward the later part of the chapter, bliss. So God, light, freedom, bliss, immortality. These five goals have consciously or unconsciously returned to us, returned to civilizations after every gap, after every interlude, and all our activities, our thoughts can be practically put under these five heads. Now, unless we have realized these five heads, implication is that civilization will continue. The question is how conscious the civilization should be in continuing this line. That is what we are going to cultivate in our consciousness. These are the five goals. Whether you use the word God or not is a different thing. God, that is to say, what is the ultimate truth in life? What exactly is that great power which has created the whole universe? Is my destiny controlled by anybody? Do I receive my energies from an inexhaustible source of energies? When this concept is followed by these questions, that becomes our quest for light, that is to say knowledge, God light. Freedom. Physically, psychologically, our entire life is a struggle for freedom. A little child, infant, crawls, stands up, falls down. It is trying to achieve the freedom of movement. It does not want to remain helpless. It falls down, cries, holds the wall, gets up again. It struggles freedom from this total inefficiency of the body to stand up to its demand of consciousness. Psychologically, we are trying to achieve more and more freedom. At the gross physical level, we crave for more money, because money means more freedom. I can do whatever I like with money. But again, because of my ignorance, I do not know when I become enslaved to the very means of freedom. For the popular thought, money is the means of freedom. A time comes, the seeker of money becomes a slave of money. He forfeits his freedom to the means. That is another irony of life. But anyway, we look for freedom. Freedom, political freedom. Freedom from prejudices, superstitions, freedom from everything. So, physically, a child struggling with his body to make it more elastic, more plastic, to our finding, discovering more and more means of freedom, economically, socially, politically. God lied freedom and bliss. Who does not want bliss? But again, the irony there is, we reduce bliss to pleasure seeking, satisfaction of desires. Whereas there is nothing as satisfaction in the realm of desires. Yes, but I think Bernard Shaw said once, there are two ironies of life, two tragedies in life. I'm sorry, you must have read in his plays. No, it is not in the play where he says it. It is an introduction to some of the plays. Two tragedies in life. One is not to get one what one wants. The other is to get what one wants. So, a gentleman in a mental asylum, with the superintendent of the asylum, he is proceeding. And somebody's family, a young man is crying, oh, oh Margarita, what did you do, oh Margarita? What is he? No, he wanted to get Margarita, he didn't get. Oh, I see. Next, another young man is shouting, oh, Margarita, oh, what? No, he got Margarita. So, irony of life is, tragedy is either not to get or to get. When we get something which we have desired, we see that the satisfaction we expected is not there. Even the fulfillment of the desire is there. That is the psychic law of reminding us that no, the bliss which you want is not to be found here, it is elsewhere. God, light, freedom, bliss, and immortality. That is a long story again. How the reflection and literature of this human aspiration for conquest of death, it has gone through the Upanishadic channels till later times. It is a great story of adventure. If possible, someday, my probably third talk, I'll try to cover it. So, dear friends, my plan was quite different, but looking at you and looking at this institution, I just felt that, well, I must say certain fundamental things which are coming to my mind, and I believe you will pardon me if I have disappointed you. And I hope with this I should end, and if anything else is there, we can discuss something.
Dada, you have another 1 hour, so you can go on.
No, I can better, if some question is there, we can ask. I never believe that I know. Your question will be also a stimulation for me to seek the answer, that's all. Don't ask me technical questions or highly academic questions. I am a student of literature. I am a creative writer in my own way. There is a different aspect of my life, but I am not a scholar. I must make it very clear. And what I never say anything in which I don't believe, so much as spiritual matters are concerned or psychological matters are concerned. That is my only forte. But I do not know informatively everything. Yes.
Thank you, Dada, so much for the new topic. Perhaps I had warned you in the beginning itself, you never know what will flow from the Ganges. And as a result, we have a kind of discourse that deals with the crisis of humanity. That he, at this stage of his life, feels, and he shares with us. And I think these concerns are greater than the academic concerns, because they involve entire humanity, all institutions, individuals, and our predicament as such put together. All of us know that Dada is a great creative writer. At the moment, I said in the beginning that he is amongst the best writers writing in English and in Odia. I think one needs to go to a Odia speaking person to find out the contribution that he has made, and the way Sahitya Academy and all prestigious institutions have recognized that. The best of him is revealed in conversations, and I believe that the time that we have at our disposal is the time for conversation with him. And the conversation can lead to new vistas of enlightenment, and this can be pertaining to his creativity, this can be pertaining to his concerns about humanity, this can be on the issues that are pertinent to us. As he said that there are very few sincere creative writers. About creative writers, Raj Shekhar said in Kavya Mimamsa, Nashte Chaura Kavya, that all poets steal from somewhere. But here is a poet or creative writer who does not steal from anywhere, rather he is sincere to himself and to the reality, and that relates it to spirituality. So spiritual creativity that we have in him. I would request each one of us to take advantage of this opportunity and interact with him, and if need be, I would request all of you also to contribute your bit to the issues that he has raised. I open this session for mutual interaction, which should lead to mutual enlightenment. Dada will be the sutradhar for that. So from Dharma Sankat, he has taken us to a point of dharma, and he has asked us to follow our swadharma. Let us follow that and make this subsequent session as a session of samvad, that is dialogue and interaction with him. Please. We have may I request each one of you to introduce yourself?
Yeah. Dada, I'm Ajay Yadav. I'm the registrar of the university. You have talked about faith. This has been something which I've been looking for a number of years, that why we are failing in our duties, why we are not able to achieve what we could achieve. And today you have given this answer that faith is something we are missing on. So my question is that we have realized that this is the gap which we have created for ourselves. So how to overcome this gap? That is the other question here, which I request you to if you can throw some light on.
Very sensible question. Very sensible question. You see, it happens like this. I believe in something. I have faith in this action, but I get a lot of disruptions. I get a lot of non-cooperation, sabotage. I get disheartened. I lose faith, begin to lose faith. Now, for riding over these critical tides, dangerous tides, I have to be conscious of one thing. First thing is, my faith is my support, and ultimately it is faith in the divine. Ultimately it is faith in the divine. If agencies on which I depend, they fail me, the divine will not fail me. The divine knows that I am faithfully trying to do something. Secondly, I will fully answer this question after 1 minute. During this 1 minute, I want to say, when I have faith to execute a work, the ideal is deep within, but there are also my mental desires, my vital desires. I will get a little promotion, a little publicity, little fame out of these things. When these things do not come, for me, you, me, everybody in the world, from the sages down, barring the liberated rishis, the sages, pandits, great scholars, down to the ordinary people, this self-esteem is always there. Question of degree of difference. Now, when they feel disappointed, that comes as a despair to me, a distraction to me. I need not elaborate on this. It's a question of one of the great ways of discovering oneself is to be critical of oneself, to find out why I am reacting in this way. Yes, he is betraying me. It is his weakness. It is not my weakness. I must be true to my strength. And ultimately, we can behave like there is a little girl, a 6-year-old girl. She used to play with a toy. Now, one of the toys is broken. But when they go to brother is 9 years and she is 6 years. And when they go to bed at night, their parents have taught them, you will pray through the divine, God, you pray after God, and then you go to sleep. So that little girl is there praying to the divine, God, please repair my toy. It is under my bed. Please repair it. And the brothers laughs. You stupid, foolish girl. You think God will come down to repair your, he will respond to your prayer. These are the prayers to which he responds. Of course he will respond. Both of them go to sleep. In the morning, the boy has got up fast and the toy remains as unrepaired as it was, broken. And then he draws, you foolish one, see, did God respond? Of course he responded. What do you mean? God says that it is time for me to give up the play. It is a time I aged enough to forget about playing with toys. That is the message I got it here. Now that is called faith. So when you are performing your duty with faith, the obligation is to enter divine. And never, never in our lifetime things are going to be fruition really. But as I said, two things. First of things, this consciousness out of millions of people have come to us. There is an act of God, then a grace from the divine. We must not fail that grace. Second is purely practical. I have to face this world again in my next life. So I do my duty, I perform my according to my inspiration with faith, but the faith ultimately in the divine, he knows how long it will take, through how many pages of disruption it must continue. Thank you.
Good morning, this is Rohit, one of the faculty members in the university.
Right.
Just continuing with this, if belief is without conviction, then there will be lack of faith. This is my first thing, just I want to understand. Second is,
one thing, my memory will not catch.
Okay, fine.
I will forget.
Belief without conviction will not lead to me to faith.
Belief without conviction. Yes. You see, to be very frank, these are subjects on which a lot of psychological discussions are there. A conviction may prove to be wrong tomorrow. Today's conviction may prove to be wrong tomorrow also. Both scientific as well as material, as well as psychological. I need to give examples. There are common sense things. But faith is what pre-exists conviction, belief, impressions, etc. My mother loved me most. I have never looked for any proof. It is something which is inborn in me. I am born of my mother, and with the faith, you see, actually speaking, spiritually speaking, the first cry a child gives after being born is an assertion of faith that there is somebody to listen to my voice and to pick me up. We are born with this assertion of faith. So this faith is something which predates our later convictions, later beliefs, later impressions. Now, very difficult to reach that faith in the core, as you are very right in saying that belief and conviction is necessary for faith to come. And sometimes the convictions may change also. So, as I was at the beginning, that is what I was inspired to say, looking at the institution, that it is built with a faith. My brother Rama did not expect the first student before the building was made. You see, it is something very, he just casually told it to me, but he, I don't know, there is a tremendous truth behind it, a tremendous law working behind it, a tremendous providential will working behind it, which, as I said, that there is going to happen like this. It will serve a purpose, then that faith is inborn in us. And we have to cultivate it, because for a long time we are living in a skeptic world, in a world where nobody believes the other persons. Like, it is unlike the ancient world today. We are living, unfortunately, in a world. So gradually we have to, through inspection of our own self, through faith, first, once I cultivate faith in the divine, then what happens, the process is like this. I must trust. Whom do I trust? This man, that man. No, I can't trust him. But I communicate with him. I begin to relate myself to him with faith in the divine and with the faith that in him also there is divine. So in course of time, 100 failures may take place. The divine in me is not going to fail me. And the divine in the person with I see, then I begin to have faith in the divine in everybody. Not in the human being. The divine in the human being. That divine in that human being may be cryptically present deep within. But my appeal is to be there whenever I communicate, if I have got a little invocation of that, my own personal faith in the divine, and communicate, it will work. In course of time, it will work. In fact, oh, unfortunately, I have not bring that. Once in a while, that newspaper doesn't come to this area. I can give you the exact report. The exact, I don't know. I wanted to bring some, the last moment I forgot everything. You see, there is a research conducted by a group of psychologists. And the research is like this. No, it's not with me at the moment. I write once editorial page for a newspaper called once in a month or so, the New Indian Express. But in this area, it is Indian Express, not New Indian Express. It's in South and Odisha, etc., etc. Of course, sometimes they reproduce other papers. I had quoted their whole research in a summary that a group of psychologists took a few hundred people and in front of half of them, there are water, glassfuls of water, containers filled with water. 100 people here, 100 people there. And for the 100 people here, the pictures of horror, negative pictures, pictures of Hitler, pictures of known infamous criminals, murders, etc. are projected. Behind the, I mean, they are asked to see the pictures and look at the water. The other people, pictures of Himalayas, the Ganga flowing, pictures of beauty in nature, sunset, sunrise, rainbow, and they are asked to see the pictures and concentrate on these waters. After a period it is seen, the waters have been crystallized. Where the pictures of Ganga, pictures of Himalayas, pictures of rainbow are there, crystals are beautiful. And here this formation, water crystallizations are bizarre, horrific, without any shape. So the power of mind and thought, they are trying to determine through the physical medium how much the vibrations can work in a liquid. Water here is liquid, of course. On the matter, it may take a longer time to work. But human consciousness is comparable to liquid. So when I appeal to the divine while talking to or while communicating or while dealing with a human being, another person, then with perfect faith and goodwill, it will work. If not today, tomorrow. If it does not make him yield immediately, he may protest, because instinct of human defense through ignorance is terrible. There are most sensible people I have seen in my life. You point out something obviously true. You point out, suppose they have taken another position. The first reaction will be, oh no, it can't be that. But subsequently, because this instinct of self-defense, which nature has given us, it makes them habitually defending themselves even when they know that they are wrong. First reaction will be that. In 97% people, the reaction will be like that. But in spite of that, when the communication is made with that particular consciousness of faith in the divine, to the divine in the other human being, in course of time it works. We are working through a very skeptic world, very difficult world. Time will pass, I don't know. But it will be successful.
Sir, I am Rakesh Desai. I teach English in the Department of English at South Gujarat University. My question is half comment, and then the question comes after this, because I am also trying to understand myself at the same time. Sir, you talk about the in a way future of man and the crisis, as I understand it, if I rightly understand.
Right.
I remember Philip Larkin's poem, a very famous poem, British poet, Church Going is the poem, where someone goes to the church, he's a skeptic, he also doesn't have much faith when he looks at the routine contemporary society now, still he goes to the church. And towards the end, the poem says, at a sort of realization that even with all this materiality and kind of general despair which you find in society, there is a need for the serious house on the serious earth. That's how the speaker describes the church, the institution of church, that there is need for serious house on the serious earth. It could be a kind of secular way of looking at the religious institution, whatever its socio-psychological need, you know, for human being, and in some way, and the poem stops there. I feel that to that extent, this faith, if I say, that faith in, to the extent by faith I mean, the need for a serious house on a serious earth. The problem begins for me after that. When we go beyond this seriousness, you know. For example, you refer to that anecdote. When Sita says that, look at these, the very effect of the sword itself. Look at the very materiality. It has its own effect and vibrations in some way. It brings some sort of violence, you know, that. Now, if the world is surrounded already with too many swords, for example, I understand the other way around. that the consciousness has its own effect at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
But if, unfortunately, the world is too much material around us, maybe it's a point in history of humankind that it happens so, you know, and I am simply, it's a fact to me, for example, whether I understand exact or not. Now, if the world is full of so much materialities, like too many nuclear weapons collected in storehouses everywhere, it has its own effect. What will consciousness do, even if it can do? So, the first thing is, should I strive only for understanding the seriousness of the temple or a church or mosque on the earth, first of all? Do I become overambitious to go beyond it in the present context? And suppose I know all this knowledge, can this knowledge take me to faith? Is there something which also happens individually, which alone can bring this knowledge to faith? Thank you, sir.
All right, very fine. The first part, of course, you have said that it is an observation, it is a comment. I mean, that's right. I mean, for the average world, even the most corrupt human being needs also a psychological solace. He goes to temple, church, mosque, etc., synagogue. He will go. After all, having said everything, there is a spark of divinity even in the greatest criminal, sinner. That's right. That will go on. Average world must run with that. Secondly, there are one force which wants to stick to that human limitations of being self-centered, ambitious. The vision does not spread beyond oneself. All selfishness and all meanness, the reason is that the instinct to self-preserve and the wrong, false notion of delight, which is satisfaction of desires and which can never come to the person ultimately. So many statements are there, dying declarations are there, where people say till the at the end, well, what have I done? I have done for nothing. Actually, but I will come to that. There is a letter, a very interesting letter, I will read out. Then, but Sri Aurobindo says, what I wanted to say is, Sri Aurobindo says that there is an evolutionary force which is trying to lead us further. And all these human weaknesses, selfishness, meanness, which are dragging us from that pull for the future, are real. The conflict is real. But if the evolutionary niceness has not become bankrupt, the evolutionary niceness which even unconsciously have brought us to this condition, whatever was there, whether ape or no ape, before humanity, it could not be aspired to become a human being. But human beings can aspire to become something else. The evolutionary force has brought us to a level, brought the earthly creatures to a particular level where the choice between what is to be abandoned and what is to be accepted can be exercised, which whatever form of ape man was there before us could not be exercised. If that force is within us, force of choice, and the evolutionary force is trying to take us beyond ourselves, beyond what we are, today or tomorrow, as you say, use the word overambitious. Should I become overambitious for that? No. That overambitious, the term I will change to aspiration. Ambition is mostly for satisfaction of my own sense needs, but aspiration is for something growing within, to aspire for something higher beyond myself. So that is there. I will just try to read a few words from Sri Aurobindo, and that will adequately answer your very right question. At present, mankind is undergoing an evolutionary crisis. Evolutionary crisis. All, it is nothing that is a family crisis, political crisis, economic crisis. There are fragmented way of looking at a crisis. Man is endowed with common sense enough to rise over all these crises, but it does not, because at present mankind is undergoing an evolutionary crisis in which is concealed a choice of its destiny. In which is concealed a choice of its destiny. For a stage has been reached in which the human mind has achieved in certain directions an enormous development, while in others it stands arrested and bewildered and can no longer find its way. So, the inevitable conclusion is the evolutionary force will try to help him if he aspires, if he chooses to transcend himself and to go further. But as you say, I agree with you, knowing fully well if men love to rot, if love to wallow in the filth it has created, I do not know. In Christianity, there is a doctrine called doctrine of election. Somebody was explaining in a very simple way. You see, my child, in heaven there are franchise, a continuous voting is going on. The franchise is limited to 3 votes. God always votes in favor of you. Devil always votes against you. The deciding vote is yours. It is the choice. Thank you very much. I think we should stop now. No? Still more?
Good afternoon to all present here. Dada, I'm Monica. I'm one of the faculty in Oro University. You spoke about freedom. You talked about psychological and physical freedom. I would like to learn more from you, because when you're talking about civilizations, many flourished and many deteriorated also. In the past, when it comes to freedom. So I would like to learn from you, what is your view on freedom with responsibility, freedom with dignity, and freedom with self, you can say self-discipline. Because most of the time, we use freedom, you know, in terms of many different notions and dimensions. So I would like to understand from you, when we are talking about psychological, mental, or physical freedom, so how much is the role of self-discipline and dignity and integrity also, and most importantly, the freedom with responsibility. So can you please throw some light on this?
Yes, yeah. Yes, yes. You are very... Satyagraha. It is a village, urban area. The real life story, kindly see, it is nothing very sensational, but real life, how the illusion of freedom at the present moment in Indian climate is working, symbolic of that. Very symbolic of that for me it has become. Now about 20 people are sitting there, about 20 policemen are there also. They could have easily, lifted them and taken out the roadside. No, they won't do it because political interference is there. There is one rickety village bus, Samar. It is the month of May or early June. Summer, and the village van, tin, some old people are there, some students are there, and bullock cart, 2-3 bullock carts have been stopped. And one rickshaw, cycle rickshaw. And my car got stopped also. I went to the Meli, these few people sitting there, smoking bidi. The leader was smoking the bidi, and I, namaskar, what is the matter? No, we are blocking the road, we are satyagraha. I said, what is the satyagraha? Knowledge, regardless for truth. So I said, what is the satya you are fighting for now? Now, you see, our village is deprived of such and such things and all these things, so that is why we have been, I said, in that case, you should go to your MLA, to distribution. No, we have gone, nothing happens. And unless the government is second, nothing will happen. So we are doing this. But I told them that, look here, gentlemen, these people who are in the bus, they have their own satya also. Somebody has to attend to the court, there is a case, and somebody is carrying something, admission, a student is going for admission. What about these satyas? Our leaders have asked us to do it. So I'm a disciplined party worker. It is the truth. I'm a disciplined party worker. I must do it. And in those days, the automatic discharge was not very popular. I'm speaking of some years ago. And then here the discharge, I said, when do you, leaders have asked, when do you lift the satyagraha? At 2 o'clock. I looked at his watch. I said, at that time it was already 1 o'clock or so. I said, in your watch it will never become 2 o'clock because you're stuck. Oh, I said, he did it like this and then. You are joking with me. I said, no, I am just pointing out. If you depend on your work, watch, it will never become 2 o'clock. Anyway, that is why of this story. I just remember I told you. So then I said, you see, this is a road, public road. We have to go. Why don't you allow us to go? It is democracy. We have the right on this road. It is passing by our village. We have the right. I said, suppose the air is passing over your village. Can you forbid me to breathe? Sky is also over your village. Do you forbid me the shadow of the clouds? I want to argue. I don't want to argue with you. Now, what has happened is, this is there all superfluous. What is real thing is, what I want to point out is, there was a rickshaw, I still learned one rickshaw was there. There was a young lady, must be about maybe 18, 19 years old, pregnant, advanced stage of pregnancy. She was held by an old woman, must be her grandmother-in-law or grandmother. She was in a state of swoon, I think, the girl herself. And the rickshaw puller was a young man. I said, what is happening? She is my neighbor. I was taking to the primary health center, which is about 2 kilometers from here. I don't, she may survive, I don't know, may not survive. I went back to the leader. I said, you allow this rickshaw to pass. How can we be partial? Law of equality. Law of equal treatment to everybody, our constitution says, no? So that law is operating now, freedom to follow that law. How can I allow somebody? How can you allow? I said, suppose she dies. Law of karma. He raises his hand up. If she dies, that is his her fate. Law of karma. Now, the confusion between the modern political slogans, modern political way of living, confusion, mixing them with our traditional laws, traditional values, it determines his freedom, freedom to act. His freedom to act in this case is take away my freedom to movement, your freedom to movement. Every rail-roko is making whole of India to ransom. A train is a symbol of the whole nation. There are Hindus, there are Muslims, there are Christians, there are rich, there are poor, there are ladies, there are students, there are young, old. The entire nation is epitomized in a train. And we proudly, like the ancient young hero stopping a demon, that is the psychology. I'm stopping a demon, a huge, powerful thing. Many subconscious things work there, and they will stop it. So this relativity of freedom is in relation to one's level of consciousness, understanding. So what Sri Aurobindo says here is that, but everybody is nevertheless trying to become free. I gave the example of a child struggling against the physical incapacity for the freedom of physical movement, and to from there, the freedom from ignorance is the real struggle. So the psycho-spiritually speaking, we are all struggling through different forms of our struggle, at different phases of our existence, for only one ultimate thing, that is freedom from ignorance. If this man were freedom from ignorance, he would not behave in this way. If I were freedom from ignorance, I would be a different person. I would be in a kind of liberated state, because real antidote to liberation is ignorance, nothing else. Savidya Javimuktai, the ancient slogan of education is that which liberates. There is no greater slogan than that. We have to bear with this present confusion. the present state of class between freedom and freedom. We have to bear with it, madam. There is no other way. Thank you. I think I should. We should stop now. It's enough.
Oh, please. I think you can voice your question. Maybe he will answer through me.
Thank you very much. Okay. My name is Gaurav.
Oh, you will not still question. Go on, move, please. Thank you. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I could not hear. Yes, please. Gautamji. Yes.
Gaurav Ashish. I'm a knowledge worker at the Aurora University. I couldn't get greedy, yeah? So if your permission is with me, may I submit?
Please.
I was just doing a bit of soul searching, sir, with reference to the Dharma Sankata that you actually pronounced as, and at this stage as the harbinger of the crisis looming large on the humankind. And with specific respect to that, sir, I was just thinking, Bella, what is that which we now need to, in our spirit, in our existence of lesser mortals, and with the spirit of guiding light, of conscience, what is that which we need to unlearn, learn, and then relearn? And should there be attached to that the Guna Dharma as the guiding light in this quest?
Very, very profound question. I can answer only in the terms of Upanishads. Janaka Yajnavalkya dialogue. Janaka asks the king, Janaka, he was a seeker, great seeker, asks the great sage Yajnavalkya, what is light for man? Yajnavalkya answer, sun is the light for man. When the sun is set, what is light for man? The moon and the stars are the light for man. When the sky is clouded, what is light for man? The fire is the light for man. Through that you can see your route. When the fire is extinguished, what is light for man? Buck is the light for man. Sound. You can hear some sound and find your way. When the sun has set, when the sky is clouded, when fire is extinguished, and when buck has become silent, what is light for man? Your soul is the light for man. So ultimately, how from external objects the Upanishad leading to the internal, the inner truth, the passage, what a method, the method that is shown from far to near. And anyway, so sir, it is true that the real guide remains within. As you know, that famous statement of Sri Aurobindo, the first thing that teacher ought to know is nothing can be taught. Because the real wisdom, the knowledge is deep within, inherent in us. We have to unfold it. And that requires discipline, that requires aspiration. You see, today the whole problem is we are living superficially in a superficially dominated world. From that, to take a little holiday and to go deep within and to live within, that is the only thing that can give us real peace. Thank you, sir. This is the only thing I can say.
Silence can be the best way to sum up the eloquence and the wisdom that we had before us. Dada began with the concern crisis, and in the crisis he gave us a hope, and that hope we found in faith. And all of us noted that the faith that he referred to is Swadharma. That is, if there is a crisis, it is because either we have become unconscious of our Swadharma, and if we are conscious, then we are not practicing that Swadharma. Swadharme nidhanam shreyam. That is what he meant when he referred to Gita. The towards the end he referred to, suggested to a point where I think Swadharma is to be seen in the light of Yoga Dharma also. That Swadharma is to be attended by Yoga Dharma, and that each individual has to find out by going within. And therein the self or inner self answers that this is the Yoga Dharma that we need to do, that we need to practice. His views on freedom were the views that often haunt us in the form of questions, but we often try not to find the right kind of answers. He mentioned he saw freedom in the terms of liberation from ignorance. Some of us would remember a 3rd century Greek text, a treatise on freedom. And in that treatise, Euvius, the philosopher, says in the beginning that the moment we begin to seek freedom, we lose our freedom. Because he says that, he gives an example of a banquet where king has invited different guests. The moment we think whether king has invited me or not, the moment we think it, we lose our freedom, because we have mortgaged our freedom. We have surrendered our freedom to the king, desire whether king invites us or not. Once we are invited, then we lose another freedom, whether we shall be sitting with the king on the same table or we shall be sitting on another table. Therefore, even if we are on the same table with the king, then am I sitting by the side of the king or not by the side of the king? And he keeps on multiplying this. We are surrendering our freedom at every moment, the moment we become victim to the aspiration or the desire for the kind of freedom that we often think of. That is why our tradition did not have the term freedom, or what was later translated as swatantrata. It was swadhin, that is to be adhin within to one's own self, swadhin. And that is why the greatest curse on the earth was to be paradhin, whether we are dependent on medicines, whether we are dependent on someone else, whether we are dependent on king's invitation or king's permission to sit along with the king or not, we lose all of them. I think what Dada indicated is that we need to go back to our own texts, to our own treatises, to our own concepts, because the moment we begin to use others' concepts, we move towards cognitive colonization, and that is something to be taken care of, at least in the academic worlds of higher education. I would submit here is that this would continue, this interaction would continue. Tomorrow we would have a session in the Discovery Hall, which is in the next building, post-end, and wherein students will also be there.
And that will be purely as scheduled earlier.
As scheduled.
I will condense all the 3 talks into one for students.
But some of our...
Of course, all are welcome.
All of them would be there, and maybe some more people can join, so that more and more people get enlightened and benefited with that. Day after, we will have the same time, 10:30 to 12:30, and we shall meet here. And then he will deal with the 3rd phase of the discourse. I'm sure that they would help us in understanding ourselves, our times, and the way we should move ahead in those directions. To our students' benefit, maybe some scholars, a couple of them are already here, and some may join on tomorrow or day after. One question, Dada, would be like, that you can respond tomorrow or day after, whenever you feel like. How do all these concerns get reflected in your writings? Because you are the only exception
who writes for children and elders both. There are, let me tell you, there is not even a single author in English from India at the moment who writes for children first and for elders at the same time, and he appeals to both the constituencies. How do these concerns, how do these realizations get manifested creatively? And this may inspire some of us to understand the creative process and may help in understanding the works that some of our research scholars have been studying, your works I mean.
Right.
And rest is your path that we shall all tread. On behalf of the university and all of us, I express sincere gratitude to Dada, and we pray to God that your blessings will continue with us, not only as they are in this visit, but subsequently when we have our students admitted to the School of Liberal Arts next year. With this, I take this opportunity to request all of you to come down to table 101, where we have arranged very humble lunch for you. Most welcome. Thank you, Dada, very much.